you for joining us today. We appreciate you tuning in to our YouTube ministries here at Messiah Baptist Church. If you've been following along, we are studying the book of Ecclesiastes. This week, we're looking at chapter 5. And as I've mentioned before, we're trying to study subject by subject instead of a verse by verse commentary. Today, I think we will discover some very wise and beautiful insights to understanding how we are to worship when we go to church. I will read chapter 5 in just a moment. But before I do, I do want to say thank you to the ladies who worked last week decorating the float for the 4th of July parade. I think they did a great job, and I'm always proud of our float. It's, I think, the hit of the hit parade. We have one of the best floats in the parade, and it was a lot of fun. A little hot last week, but still we had a great time. Hundreds of people turned out all along the way. And I want to say thank you to Lee for last Sunday night fixing hamburgers for everyone. He did a great job, and we appreciate every time he does, every time he fixes something like that. It's a blessing to everybody. All right, now if you would, open your Bibles with me to the book of Ecclesiastes, to chapter 5. I hope you've got your Bibles there with you. I'm going to read the chapter, and I'm sure I will not finish as far as all the different thoughts we have, but I hope to be a blessing to you. Now, one of the things that Solomon teaches in this is that we are to be swift to hear and slow to speak when we go to worship the Lord. In other words, we should be listening more than we're talking when we go to church. Chapter 5, beginning in verse 1. Keep thy foot when thou goest to the house of God, and be more ready to hear than to give the sacrifice of fools. For they consider not that they do evil. Be not rash with thy mouth, and let not thine heart be hasty to utter anything before God. For God is in heaven, and thou upon earth. Therefore let thy words be few. For a dream cometh through a multitude of busyness, and a fool's voice is known by the multitude of words. When thou vowest a vow, or when you make a promise unto God, defer not to pay it, for he hath no pleasure in fools. Pay that which thou hast vowed or promised. Better it is that thou shouldest not vow than that thou shouldest vow and not pay it. Suffer not thy mouth to cause thy flesh to sin, neither say thou before the angel that it was an error. In other words, I made a promise to God, and now I'm trying to back out on it, and I tell people I really didn't mean it. It's best that you listen more than you speak. And don't tell somebody, well, I made a mistake. Just be quiet. Don't make a fool out of yourself with the words that you say. Wherefore, should God be angry at thy voice and destroy the work of thine hands? For in the multitude of dreams and many words, there are also divers vanities, but fear thou God. If thou seest the oppression of the poor, and violent perverting of judgment and justice in a province, marvel not at the matter, for For he that is higher than the highest regardeth, and there be higher than they. Moreover, the profit of the earth is for all. The king himself is served by the field. He that loveth silver shall not be satisfied with silver, nor he that loveth abundance with increase, that is also vanity. When goods increase, they are increased that eat them. And what good is there to the owners thereof, saving the beholding of them with their eyes? The sleep of a laboring man is sweet, whether he eat little or much, but the abundance of the rich shall not suffer him to sleep. There is a sore evil which I have seen under the sun, namely, riches kept for the owners thereof to their own hurt. But those riches perish by evil travail, and he begetteth a son, and there is nothing in his hand. As he came forth of his mother's womb, naked shall he return as he came, and shall take nothing of his labor, which he may carry away in his hand. And this also is a sore travail, that in all points as he came, so shall he go. And what profit hath he that hath labored for the wind? All his days also he eateth in darkness, and he hath much sorrow and wrath with his sickness. Behold, that which I have seen, it is good and comely for one to eat and to drink and to enjoy the good of all his labor that he taketh under the sun all the days of his life, which God giveth him, for it is his portion. Every man also to whom God hath given riches and wealth, and hath given him power to eat thereof, and to take his portion, and to rejoice in his labor, this is the gift of God. For he shall not much remember the days of his life, because God answereth him in the joy of his heart. Solomon begins this chapter speaking to us about respecting and honoring God's house. Remember, you're going to worship the Lord. We are to have an awesome reverence for the house of God and for those who teach us the Word of God. For they watch for your souls. Oftentimes, this is something I've observed in my lifetime, 50 years of work in the ministry, I've observed that oftentimes children who have grown up in church and around the things of God oftentimes lose their respect for the house of the Lord. And I don't necessarily know why they do. It just happens. But we are to have an awesome respect and reverence for the house of God. On Sundays and Wednesdays, here at Messiah Baptist Church, we go to the Lord's house. That's our church, located at 7101 Baker Boulevard. It's the place that we come together to worship the Lord. And I want to admonish you, no matter where you go to worship the Lord, make sure that your motives are pure. Sometimes people go to church just to make business contacts. Sometimes they just go there for the social aspect of it. But our motives should be pure, and that is, we're going there to learn and to worship and to fellowship with God and with His people. We must remember that worshiping God is our priority. When we go to the house of God, be slow to speak and swift to hear. In other words, we should be going to the house of the Lord to learn. In the New Testament, Jesus said, "Where there are two or three gathered together in his name, that there he would be in their midst." The church house is the place that we go to learn about God. It is also a place, oftentimes people go to church, and oftentimes people get saved at church. And when a person is saved, the church has the right and the authority to baptize those who put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ. Also, we go to church together, we take communion, we dedicate our children to the Lord at church, we fellowship, we praise and worship the Lord there at our church. Solomon warns about speaking too often and saying too much when we go to the Lord's house. In other words, he's trying to tell us that it's more important for us to listen and not try to act like we already know it all. And if you make a promise to God or a vow, what we read in the chapter 5, if we make a promise or a vow to God, it is very important that we keep it. We should go to church both to worship God and to learn about God. When you go to church, learn to be sensitive to the working of the Holy Spirit. The Bible talks about it as that still small voice. Keep an open heart and an open mind. Listen for the Lord to speak to you, and do only as God and the Spirit of God lead you. Otherwise, Solomon says, your mouth will cause you to sin. That is, you'll say too much, and you'll not be able to keep your promises. So, the lesson is, be swift to hear and slow to speak. Otherwise, your mouth will cause you to appear to be very foolish. Solomon tells us it is better not to vow a vow or make a promise to God than to make a promise and not keep it. God bless you until we meet again next Wednesday.